with us. He is presently working as an associate professor in the Information Technology Department at King Abdullah University, Jeddah, in Saudi Arabia. He did his PhD in 2011 in a software engineering from King's College, London, UK. He has published a number of good research papers in the Web of Science and the SCI research publications and various international and national conferences. It is a great privilege to have you, sir, with us. Today, sir, will enlighten us on a very interesting and important topic, how we can prepare the robots with our open source tool and the other different tools. Now, I request, sir, to please take over the session and enlighten us, sir. Please.
Thank you so much. Once again, Professor Buddha, thank you so much for your invitation. And yes, today, actually, I think some of you may know me from the previous section. Today, we're going to talk from a practical implementation of you about robotics. Now, robotics is a very misunderstood area because they require people from different disciplines. So they require people with programming background, programmers, which engineers. So there is a noise coming. So they require people with different specialities. For example, you have the people with a technical background, engineering background, that hate programming. I remember I was talking to a mechanical engineer and he said, I became a mechanical engineer because I hate programming. And on the other hand, you have the programmers who don't know anything about mechanical engineering and who became mechanical engineering because they want a more clean office job. So there is a, this is good actually. I will not say this is a bad thing. This is a good thing because robotics are not where they're supposed to be. They are still very, very primitive, which means there is a window of opportunity for us. We can actually, you know, start. It's very easy to start building robotics and to enter the field. And once you enter the field, the only limit is your imagination. Before I go to actually how to build a robot, and you will see it's very simple. It's nothing, you know, difficult as it's quite simple, actually. It's not difficult at all. I will just, you know, give you some examples of some wonderful applications that you can actually build with simple knowledge about robotics. So this is what you see on your screen, actually. It's one of the models that we have, you know, filed for a patent, a US patent. So what you see here, basically, this is a robot to fight coronavirus. These here are UV light lamps. And this in the middle, as you can see, is also a UV light lamp. We know that UV can kill viruses. So instead of putting just this UV light on a car or any platform or move it by hand, we can place it in this spider looking, actually they call them a hexapod because it has six legs, kind of robot. The advantage of this over a simple car is that it can basically clean itself, it can move around, it can go to any surface, and the advantage is given by its design. So you can see here the lamp in the middle and the other legs. And you can also see the different motors. These are called servo motors. And they can move from 0 to 180 degrees. So we have in robotics something called degrees of freedom. So we have basically every motor, every joint is a degree of freedom. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 per leg. Okay, so how many we have in total? Anyway, we have like 24 degrees of freedom, okay? Which means this is a big number of, sorry, is there a problem with the audio?
Okay. No problem in the audio, everything is fine.
Okay. Okay, great. So this basically allows the robot to move on different surfaces, especially in a nosocomial environment, but also it's not about movement. It's these arms here, these robotic arms, can go to different blind surfaces. Now, I will not talk more about this robot because it's still our patent. I'm the PI there, but this is still under investigation. But similar robots, within just a lamp, different design, placed on a vehicle with remote control, okay, they cost right now, if you want to buy them for the hospital, $130,000 each. Okay, and this is just one example that I gave you from robotics, and I'm talking about something extremely easy. This is just 24 motors, one microcontroller to control it. I mean, that's all. It's a very easy thing to do. I can give you a lot of examples of what amazing things you can do with robots and IoT. Okay, it's an amazing area and it's a very easy area. So let's come to today's, I hope I motivated you. Okay, if not for the science itself, at least for the financial benefits that it can potentially bring. So now that I hope you're motivated, let's come to our class. So what I will do today, I will keep flying over the lecture notes, because obviously I only have 2 hours. Okay, so we will not cover the whole thing. This is basically, I have designed this course to be a 6 hours total course, and it has some requirements that we don't fit right now, because it's not designed really for online. Anyway, so let's start with a little bit. So what we will do today, we're going to deliver this class. And by the end of this class, you should be able to build your own robots. So you will know what equipment to buy, where to buy it from, how to design the robot, how to program the robot, how to build the robots. So the whole process from A to Z. So definitions. Robot. What is the word robot means? Robot is derived from a Czech word robota, meaning labor, worker. It first appeared in a 1920 play of Rosam's Universal Robots. Now, some definitions. Don't worry, I'm going to skip the boring part. We will go to the programming part soon. So, according to the Robotics Institute of America, a robot is a reprogrammable, multifunctional manipulator designed to, you see the chat? Here, okay. I can make it full screen, but the problem is these things here. I'm afraid of. Shall I try full screen? Make it easier.
Full screen is on this.
Okay, let's try, but I will have to sacrifice. Okay. So it's a reprogrammable multifunctional manipulator designed to move parts, material parts, tools, or specialized devices through various program motions for the performance of a variety of tasks. So what do we get from here? Actually, I will summarize these two in the next slide. The ISO defines a robot as an automatically, so here you have reprogrammable, here you have automatically. Reprogrammable, again, multi-purpose manipulator, programmable in 3 or more axes, which may be fixed in place or mobile for the use in industrial automation applications. So the main difference between the two actually is this one. It doesn't have to be for industrial applications, it can be for anything, any type of use. I just put Wikipedia here because sometimes Wikipedia is more clear. So, what is a robot? Typically, a robot will have several, though not necessary, all of the following properties. It's not natural, so it has been artificially created, can sense its environment, can manipulate things in its environment, has some degree of intelligence, is programmable, and can make dexterous, coordinated movements, and appears to have some intellect, some intelligence, we call it autonomous. And I think this is pretty much the most clear definition of what is the robot. A lot of people are talking, okay, we have mechatronics and we have robotics and we have automatic and we have autonomous. So this can be a little bit of confusing for us because most of us, we are computer science guys, right? So what's going on there? But we all hear the word mechatronics. We say, what is it for me? I mean, what can I do there? So mechatronics is a is basically the joint between mechanical, electronics, and computer engineering. On the other hand, robotics is just a part of mechatronics. So anything from traffic lights to the toaster to robotics belongs to mechatronics. Robotics is just an application of mechatronics. The main difference between basically the traditional mechatronic systems and robotics is in the inputs and the decision making. A toaster at your home cannot make, cannot basically, doesn't have all the properties of robotics. I was about to say it cannot make any intelligent decisions, but I'm sure that some toasters can make an intelligent decision, but they don't have all the properties. They cannot move, for example. Now, mechatronics basically system is provide its own inputs, where robotic system acquires its own inputs. So the mechatronic system is mainly by default automatic, where robotics is autonomous. And we will explain what do we mean by autonomous. Let's assume that we have a traffic light. Okay, this traffic light has a timer, and we will see in a minute how to build that. So this timer says every 5 seconds or every 1 minute, turn from red to green. This is done automatically. There is no human hand doing it. We don't have a human keep pressing the switch or something. This is done completely automatically. So it is an automatic system. But it is not an autonomous system. Because it doesn't take live feed from the environment. Now, let's see another case. Let's have another case. Let's assume that we have a smart traffic light, like the ones my students are building here, and they're so crazy with. We had more than 5-6 projects in that area. So let's assume that traffic light has basically a camera. It understands how many cars are waiting. So it has input. It takes input from the environment through its sensors and make some intelligent decisions and decide when to switch to green or to red or and so on automatically, but based on the input from its environment. Then it's autonomous. So let's summarize here. The main difference really between autonomous and automatic is that the automatic doesn't care about the input, it's pre-programmed. It does not depend on environmental input. It's not dynamic. It just depends on its standard instructions, A, B, C. While the robot, it will react, or any autonomous system will react based on the input from its sensors. So is that clear, everybody? Okay. So, input process output system. I'm just trying to bring now robotics to CS, to what we understand. Is a robot still an IPO system? Well, yes. The input can come from sensors, network, or any other device. The process can happen in a microcontroller, a normal computer, or LAN station. And the output can be given to motors, to screens, and any other devices. Here, I just have some application. I mean, I started this by an application of robots, but that we are doing here. But you can see they have many, 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 many applications. So you see production light, manipulators, entertainment, housework, medical, defense, education, here exploration. There's so many things you can do. And quite easily, that's the main thing, right? Simplicity. Here, I'm not going to continue talking about control, and let's leave the theory. And let's move to the sensors. So I will cover sensors, and then I will cover the programming, how we program this. Okay, so it's very easy how we build the robot. It's extremely easy. It's very, very easy. You know how to write hello world in Java, you know how to build a robot. It's as simple as that. So, how do we build a robot? We have to understand what are the parts that the robot has. So, the robot has three parts, as I saw in the IPO before. It has some sensors, it has a processor, a microcontroller, or a PC, or some kind of processing to process the input. And it has some output. This output can be actuators, like motors, basically, or maybe an image or something. It gives some output. So input, process, output. What would be taught from year one in the university? Okay, so let's have a look at the sensor. So basically, if I want to build a robot to do something, I just take ready-made sensors, I take a ready-made computer, I connect the sensors to the computer, and I connect the computer to the motor, and that's it. I'm not building anything, I'm just connecting ready-made devices, integration, which we are very good at. Because most of our job is integration. So in the, okay, let's continue. So if we're going to talk about what is a sensor, what are the differences between analog and digital sensors, over a variety of sensors, an example of a custom sensor, how we can build our own sensors, sensors deviation, what is a motor, IAC, DC, stepper motors, gearboxes, actuators, and finally, linear and rotational actuators, motors. So once I cover this, then this covers the sensors and the motors. Then you will have a very clear idea of what we can do with the robots and how to build them. Okay, so what is a sensor? A sensor is a noun from the word sense. And this is a device that can sense. Humans, we humans also have sensors. A sensor is also called a device that can measure physical quantity and convert it to signal, which can be read by an observer or by an instrument. Now, humans, animals, we also have sensors. We have our eyes, we can see, we can smell, right? We can touch. We have so many sensors. Again, I'm not going to talk too much here, but we have something called detection theory. Sorry, I'm jumping all because this is a 6-hour course, and I'm trying to shrink it to 1 hour plus. So I will focus more on the programming and how to actually do it than the theory, but still I have to cover some theory just to set the scope. So detection theory. Robots is the idea of the sensors actually go back to the radars that were used mainly in the Second World War, mainly by the British, who wanted to predict when the German Luftwaffe, the German Air Force, was attacking them. Now, the main thing we care about here is sensitivity. So how sensitive is the sensor? The bias, which is the extent to which one response is more portable, probable than another one. So what are the chances of accuracy, if you prefer? What are the chances of that what I'm sensing is correct? What am I sensing, basically, to recognize what I'm sensing? And the resolution, which is the smallest change that can detect the quantity that is measuring. Now, sensors and detection theory. So sensors are detection devices able to discern between signals and noise. The sensitivity refers to how hard or easy to detect that a target stimulus is present from background events. Now, there are two types of sensors, and that's the main thing you care about. One of the main things you care about right now. You have analog and digital sensors. Now, in computer science, we wrongly think of analog and digital as zero or one. If it's digital, analog, some kind of a number. In robotics and in computer science, actually, digital means what? Means electricity, high voltage electricity, or low voltage electricity. So if I have a high voltage electricity, I will get one. If I have a low voltage electricity, I will have zero. If I have no electricity, I will get minus one, which means error. Something is wrong, something is broken. But let's leave the error case for now, and let's focus at electricity, no electricity, zero or one. So the digital, the digital sensor is high voltage electricity or low voltage electricity, zero or one. These are the two things I can get. High or low, yes or no. Now, the analog sensors, on the other hand, they can give us a number. What is this number? What number can they give us? In Arduino, you can get a number from 0 to 1024. Okay, that's all. 0 to 1024. So let's say that I want to measure the temperature with a thermometer. Probably a thermometer is going to give you from minus, let's say, 40 to plus 50. Right? Still, no. The sensor is going to give you from 0 to 1024. Then you have to find the limits of the sensor and convert 0 to 1024. Map that value to the actual thermometer data. Now, I'm just going to show you now a number of sensors before we can move, to the models. So we have this analog sensor. This one, it's used to tell us how much electricity actually we are getting through a link. This one, it's an ECG. Okay, it's a sensor. You place these ones on your hand here, and it tells you how much electricity, it measures the amount of electricity produced by your muscles. Now, we are using this in wearables and exoskeletons
to actually from your, so if you have lost your hand, we can create an artificial hand. So through this we give signals, so we control the artificial hand, the robotic hand. This one here is a flex sensor, again analog sensor. So it gives us basically as you are rotating, as you are bending the sensor, it tells you the amount of bending. So if I bend it completely, I will get 1024. If I have it straight, I will get zero, or vice versa, depending on the polarity. This one is a digital tilt sensor. So it knows how much we are moving, how much we are tilting the device, if there is a lot of movement or not. Sorry, is it okay now? All right, okay. This is the digital crash sensor, so it will know if the robot touches surface. Okay, this is used, this is an IR infrared sensor. This is a motion detection sensor. So you know if there is a motion, you will get yes or no based on if there is a motion or not. Digital weight sensor, like a scale, tells you, you know, how heavy something is. Infrared sensor. This one is a sonar. So it's like, I will come back to this. So this one, you all seen this one, right? Every time you see a robot, you see this ultrasonic sensor. This is kind of a trademark of robotics nowadays. Now this one, it's an ultrasonic or distance sensor, and it can return the distance between your robot and any obstacle. So, how it works? It has one speaker and one microphone. The speaker is going to send out an ultra sound, ultrasonic. Why we call it ultra? Because it's above the frequencies that the human ear can hear. And once it hits an obstacle, it's going to reflect the sound back through the microphone. Now, I know the speed of sound, which is standard. CCTV is a digital sensor, but it's a different one, sorry. CCTV is kind of, it's a camera, basically. We will come back to that. So, so we can basically, through by calculating, since I know what time I send the signal, I know what time I receive the signal, I know the speed of sound, simply I can do the maths and I can calculate how far the obstacle is from my location. This specific one can do 0.2 centimeters to 2 meters. So this one here is a waterproof ultrasonic sensor. So it's exactly the same, but it can do it underwater for submarines or any other application. Maybe in a pot or something. Yes. This one, it's a kind of more advanced sensor. This is a LiDAR. It's doing the same job like the ultrasonic, but it is using lasers. And this one is a 360. So basically it will create a 2D map. So this one from, you see the opening, it will bombard the area with 4,000 laser samples. So it will create a map. It will say, okay, the distance between me and that is there. The distance, it's an array, basically, a two-dimensional array, and it's going to put to fill it with obstacles. This one is an anemometer. Anemos means wind in Greek language. Meter means I measure. So anemometer is the measurement of the wind, and it has these traps, wind traps here, that will make it move. So based on this, the speed of vision, we know the speed of the wind. Very, very useful for Asia Pacific, like Philippines or Malaysia, where they have many typhoons. And by the way, this is how they predict the typhoons. They have placed these weather stations in multiple locations. This is a very interesting one. This is a dust sensor. It measures the amount of dust. This is extremely useful for Saudi Arabia or Middle Eastern environment. Also another useful sensor, this is an alcohol detector. So it's using an MQ3 probe, which basically, okay, how all these gas detectors work? They have a catalyst inside. So when this catalyst reacts with the potential, with the target substance, it's going to do a chemical reaction. When we have a chemical reaction, any chemical reaction produces electricity, heat and electricity. So we capture the amount of electricity. The more intense the chemical reaction, the higher the amount of electricity. So this way we know that if I get a lot of electricity, the alcohol, the consumption of alcohol in that, by that person was quite high. I think I have here. So this is an application of the same sensor. So, you know, sometimes they do, the police stops you for alcohol tests, as we call them. And if you're too drunk to drive, then you face the legal. Now, this is a gas sensor. So again, it works with the same logic. So it has a catalyst inside here. And when it reacts with a certain, with a target substance, the target type of gas, it's going to produce electricity, which we capture, and we know if that gas is present or not. These are wonderful life-saving stuff. Wonderful, wonderful. This is a more complex one. This is a complete weather station with thermometers and many, many other things. Again, a wonderful, sensor. This one is a funny one. It's a 3D gesture sensor. It's basically have five photocells. One photocell here, 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 and one in the center. Now, so what is the photocell doing? The photocell knows if you are blocking the light. So if I have the sensor here, if I move my hand over the sensor, automatically I'm creating a shadow. So if this one, what is the meaning of shadow? Shadow means less electricity, right? So if this one starts producing less electricity first, that means that somebody ended from here, or from here, or from here, or from here. So basically, I can move my hands, and I can actually move a mouse, the cursor of a mouse, or a robot, or something, simply by moving my hand like this. It's a nice one, really. This one is the touch. So every time you touch in an area, you produce electricity from your pressure in that area. So I have an array at the back, like you can see here, or here. And this is how all the touch screens are working. Now, again, another very popular sensor. This is a 10 degrees of freedom IMU sensor, like the one that you have in your mobile phone. Actually, most mobile phones have 11 DOU. So what is this doing? This knows it has a three-axis gyroscope, three-axis accelerometer, so it can tell you your position against Earth, okay? And it can tell you the acceleration towards each axis, so six there, plus barometer, so it can tell you how up or down you are, plus seven, plus campus, another three, 10. Now your mobile phone has a more advanced inside, it has 11, so it has this 10 plus gyroscope, sorry, plus GPS. So this comes on 6 axes or 9 axes or 10 or 11, depending on in the order that we mentioned earlier. And it's using the robots to be able to navigate. This is a must have in every robot. So the robot can navigate. This is just a laser light. This is an infrared laser light. This one is a photocell, so it can tell you how much light is in the room. So if there is no light in the room, you will get zero. If you hit it with a laser, then it will give you the value of 1023. This is a microphone. Okay, this one is a microphone. It will tell you again, by the voice, also produce electricity, right? So this is a microphone sensor, sound sensor, basically it's a microphone sensor. Microphone is not just used to record noises or sounds. I will give you another example. There was a search and rescue robot, and it was developed by an array of microphones. Okay, so yes, of course, I will share all the lecture notes, don't worry, for the whole course. And if you want to prepare your own course using this, I can support you. I will give you all the lecture notes, including the programming ones. I'll just share an application here before I come forward. So I will just give you an example, okay? Imagine let's assume that I have an array of 4 microphones, right? So imagine a square, and at each corner of a square, I place a microphone. So I have an array of 4 microphones, right? Now, if a sound, don't forget that these microphones just give me an integer, just give me a value from 0 to 1023. So each of them will give me a value from 0 to 1023. Now, let's assume that the front left microphone gives me 800, while the other microphones give me less than 600. That means that there is a source of sound, a loud source of sound, coming from front left. So I can move the robot there, front left, and go towards that source of sound. Then, in the next iteration, we see that the source of sound comes from the right. So now I have to move right. So basically, you can create a robot that if you shout in the house, it will find you based on your voice. Also, this is how the search and rescue robots work. They can detect the sound, they know where the sound is coming from, and they start going towards the sound. This one is an analog soil moisture sensor. So it for, you know, farming. It can basically tell you if the ground is good or bad. Sorry, I'm not into farming. A temperature sensor, I'll tell you the temperature in your area, like a thermometer. This is temperature plus humidity. This is humidity only. This one goes inside the water and can tell you how photoelectric is the water. I don't know what's the meaning of that, but I assume it has some uses in chemical engineering. This one is one of my favorite sensors. This is a pressure sensor. So it knows how much, if I push this with my finger or a knife or something, it knows how much pressure I'm putting. So it can measure the pressure from 0 to 80 kg. This is a GPS sensor, and this is how to connect it. We will come back to that later. This is a touch sensor. This is a joystick. And this is how to write the code for this. I will come to the code later. Gyroscope and accelerometer, some other sensors like Kinect, EEG. EEG basically gets you connect to the brain and it gets different signals. Because as we said, each every time you're thinking, depending on what mental actions you are doing, a different part of the brain is going to produce its chemical reactions, right? So it's going to produce electricity. So we are capturing this electricity and we know which area is working. Now we don't know what you are thinking, but we know which area of the brain is working. So, for example, we know if a student is thinking or participating, or what, you know, we know, or it's trying to do maths, or, you know, we know the different areas of the brain. Again, another EMG sensor, we get the signals from the muscles. This is a potentiometer. So this is the volume control that you have in your car, right? So this is basically, it's like a variable resistor. And the more I rotate it from the one side, it will give me zero. From the other side, it will give me 1023. And there are many, many, many more sensors. Acoustic sound vibration sensors, automotive, transportation, chemical, electric, environment, and many, 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 many more sensors. And you can find more sensors in that link. You can even build your own sensor. So here, for example, let's how to build our own accelerometer. So you can have a pressure sensor. Imagine you have a box, okay? You put pressure sensors here, 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 and here. And then you put a sphere in the middle. Now, since each side of the box has a pressure sensor, so you have six pressure sensors, when this box is moving up, because of gravity, the pressure, the ball will go down, right? So there will be more pressure at the bottom. So the bottom sensor is going to record more than the rest. So you know that this box is going up. If it's moving forward, then the pressure sensor at the back is going to have more pressure, right? So you know that it's going. So basically, you can predict the direction. This is if you want to understand how the sensors work and how to build your own sensor. So by mixing this, you can build your own sensor. Or a color detector. I can have a photocell and I can have a light. If I have an object, I hit the object with a light and I will get the reflection. Different colors have different reflections. So based on the reflection, I know what color it is. Now, different sensors have different dynamic errors, drift, noise, hysteresis, and out of range errors. So these are different things you should consider. Motors. So how much time we have? Because I see a lot of thank you. We still have time, right? How much time we have left?
It's 1 hour, 15 minutes.
Yeah.
All right. I will try then to speed up from here, and because I want to cover the programming. So there are different types of motors. You have the ones that convert chemical energy to kinetic energy, the steam, kinetic energy, and finally the electrical motors. Okay, so these are the electromechanical motors. And you know, I think you all know the theory how the motor works, right? So you're all okay with this. You all know the logic behind the motors, right? And the different types of motors. So I can cover it if you want, but I just want to save some time for the programming. So this one is a brass motor. So this motor has two permanent magnets here, and it is changing the polarity of the electric coil. So this brass, and we call it brass because it looks like a brass that we use to paint the walls, right? So this brass there, basically, it has a coil. So I'm just changing the polarity of this. I have the two permanent magnets at the side. This way I make my motor to move. And this, so this is a very common one. This is one of the most common types of motors. This one is a brushless motor, so it doesn't have a brush. Instead, it has a permanent magnet at the center. And I'm changing the polarity here. So if I change the polarity of A, I give it a push towards B, from B towards C, and so on. So this way, by changing the polarity at the sides, at A, B, and C, I can make it move and hold. Move and hold. Now, this one is stronger and faster. Okay? However, I cannot control where exactly it's going to stop. I cannot stop it and hold it, right? However, here, because I have different ABCs, I can make it move and hold it. Or I can make this move exactly from A to B or from A to C and hold it there, stop it there. Not continuously rotation. I can do continuously rotation if I want. More slow than before. But the main advantage is that I can make it move from A to B or one step. So these are called stepper motors because they can move step by step. Okay, these motors are very, very accurate. And these are the motors used in, they are both used in robotics, but if you want accuracy, these are the motors to go for. So the ones that, the arms that do the surgeries, the arms that I showed you before, all of them are using stepper motors. And this is the logic behind the stepper motor. This is how to connect the motors. Again, I will come back to that later, okay? And this is how to program them. We will come back to this. Okay? So this is the logic of the stepper motors. I have multiple magnets, and I can make them move a number of steps, as many steps as I want. These are servo motors, which are stepper motors plus gearbox. Again, this is how to program them. And now, I will come back to this, how to program the motors. But first, let's talk about, okay, so what we know so far, we know a little bit of theory about robotics. We know that it's nothing, it's not a rocket science. Okay? It's a very simple thing. We know that you have sensors and motors. And what we are missing now is the brain. Okay, while there are many microcontrollers to use inside the robot, I will go for this one. I mean, you can use Raspberry Pi, you can use many, many, many. But I personally go for this one, for Arduino. Because Arduino is kind of the de facto standard in robotics. It's like Cisco in networking. Okay? Now, I know it looks scary for people who don't have experiments. And don't have experience, sorry, on this. But it's nothing going on here. I will come straight to the design. Let me make this full screen. Now, is this, please tell me that you can all see this clearly, because this is very important. Is it clear? Very clear. Can you see the A1, A0 and A1, A2? Okay, so first of all, it's very, 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 very simple. This is a very simple device. This is an input process output device. Okay, it's a very low consumption one. So with a small battery, you can have it running for more. It's not a very powerful processor. It's a very weak processor. You can do very, very simple operation. So let's start. How can I connect a motor and a sensor here? And how I connect this to the computer? How can I power this? Okay. How can I program this? How can I upload my code here? So, first thing first, what you do is Can you see this is a USB port? So you connect this USB port to the PC, to the computer. We will see how to connect to the computer later, step by step, and how to program step by step. Now, here, these are called the digital ports. So digital means high or low, high voltage electricity or low voltage electricity. This little snake symbol here, can you see? Like next to 6, next to 5, next to 3. These are digital pulse width modulators, which means they can send a pulse. What is a pulse? We'll talk about it later. And here you see the RX and TX. So 0 and 1 are the serial port ones. So you can use this receive and send if you want to connect this Arduino to another Arduino by cable and create a network of Arduinos, which is something that you will have to do very often. Now, on the other side of the board, okay, can you see the A0, A1, A2, A3, A4, A5? So this is analog 0, analog 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. This one, again, is input. The digitals, except the pulse width. No, actually, all the digitals can be used for input or output. So you can send electricity from here or receive electricity. On the analog ones, you can only receive electricity. And they will convert this, so they can receive electricity from 0 to 5 volts, and they will convert this electricity to a value from 0 to 1023. Here, I have this one. If you give electricity here, it will reset button. It will reset the system. Here, it can give you 3.3 volts output. Here it can give you 5 volts output. You have two grounds here. Why two grounds? Because you have 3.3 volts and 5 volts. So each of them must have its own ground. Okay. So this is if you want to give electricity from Arduino to your sensors. And if you want to power the Arduino, you can use this one here for 5 to 9 volts. Or if your system is very low energy, has very, very low energy consumption, it can take electricity from the USB directly, no need for anything here. So either you can plug a battery or something here, or you can give electricity directly through your USB, through the computer. And I see that most of the computer scientists, they have a permanent connection between this and the computer. Why? Because the computer has, we're more familiar with the computers and give us more control. So if I connect my normal laptop with this one, that will allow my laptop through this device to have access to sensors and motors. So I can do all the intelligent programming on the laptop rather than here. And this is what makes amazing robots, actually. But we will come to architecture later. Now, Arduinos come to different sizes, and they're very, very cheap. I think this costs like less than $9. So we are talking for very, very cheap equipment. So this is so small, so small. It can even fit in a smartwatch. This is a little bit bigger, but more standard. So you have Arduino for any size you can imagine. No need for this. If I want to program it, so please, because this is important, are we all okay with the ports? So basically digital ports here, they can receive electricity or they can give electricity. And analog ports here, they can only receive electricity. Are we okay with that? The A1, A0, A0, A1, A2. Analog ports. I just want to type here. Analog means 0 to 1023. Okay. and it's in sorry, input. Okay, clear? So, are we clear with these concepts? So from the analog, I can only receive electricity. Here, I can either give electricity or receive electricity. We will see, because now we're going to use them in the code. So before I start the programming, how do we connect this wonderful device to the computer, and how do you install? So you can just download the software. Okay, so if you type here Arduino IDE, so this is the software. Okay, you can download it from here. It's an open source software. And you can download it directly from here for Windows, whatever you want. I can give you the link here for everyone. Okay, it's open source, it's free. No need to do it now, okay? I mean, this is just an informative session, right? No need to download anything now, but just to have it for the record. So you basically download it, you know, start it, and then this is how the ID looks like. Here, let me go back to full screen. So this is how it looks like. So you have this window where you write your code. You have this one to verify your code before you upload it. Stop. New, open file, save files. Now, the important ones are the verify and upload. So what is the upload going to do? It's going to take this code from your laptop or your computer and put the code in the, compile the code and upload the compiled executable code to the Arduino. Once you finish the program, Arduino can run this without any for computer. And finally, the monitor. Now, let's see how difficult it is to program Arduino. Okay, these are all the Arduino commands that exist. You have setup and loop. I will talk about the structure later, but check it out. Control structures. Traditional programming, so easy. If, else, for, switch case, while, do while, break, continue, return, go to, data types, void, boolean, char, unsigned char. It's like a normal language, right? I mean, leave this structure, okay? This one, we know it. Standard C or C++, 100 and even 90% same with Java. This one, the same. Actually, it looks too familiar with C and C++. Why? Because it is nothing more than a C++ library. That's why. Again, analog references. So leave this analog and digital. But everything else, we already know it, right? We all know the standard syntax. And I will show you the syntax here. Okay, this is how it looks like, the code. String, hello. Yes, it is open source. So you can write your own language, and I have a paper on how to write your own language here. If you want to replace these commands with, I don't know, Urdu or something. So you see that the syntax, very, very, we know that, right? String, hello, here, void setup. Okay, this is a method, right? A void method. Don't care about this serial, and we will explain that later. Okay? You see, the syntax is very, very familiar to us. I will come to this code later. So most of these commands are very clear to us. We are familiar with them. The only thing it's new is the structure, which I will explain in a minute, and these commands here, digital and these are some constants that they have declared. Don't worry about them. So these are digitals and analogs. Now, digitals are some three commands, just three methods. That's all. Three methods dealing with the digital IOs, digital ports. While analog IO, there are three commands dealing with the analog ports. This is the difference. Everything else is 100% the same. Okay? Now, okay, so let's talk a bit about the structure before I continue explaining these commands. Sorry, actually, we have to take a 1 minute break here because it's prey time and I cannot compete. I don't want my voice to compete with all the mosques in Jeddah. So 2 minutes break, let's wait for Adam to finish and we continue. If you want to type something now is your chance, okay? If you have any questions, type now so I can answer. So while we're waiting 1 or 2 minutes, just I can answer any questions on the chat. It's in the lecture notes. Everything is in the lecture notes. I will give you the lecture notes. I can even help you to design your own. Everything is open source, everything. But you can use it for a commercial solution. Italy and India, they are even use it in the military. The 80 mega, okay, not the Arduino, the microcontroller, the chip, the 80 mega. But really, because this is 2020, 2021 is coming, machine learning, robotics, all these technologies, you must have a course. You have to open. I don't know if Professor Hoda is here, but you must have a course, an elective course in robotics. You must have an elective course in virtual reality. You must have a lot of courses in machine learning, because this is what it's the trend right now.
You are absolutely correct, Dr. George. I'm here attending your lecture as one of the attendees. You are absolutely correct. We have already added robotics, machine learning, virtual reality and augmentation as a separate courses in the bachelor degree program of
elective courses, yes, but at least you should be in the here we open them and we don't offer them. But when somebody from outside check on us at the university for ranking, we say yes, we have these courses. But we don't open the courses. But we still have them in the curriculum. It's a C library, basically. They use, you know how to build your own C library, right? You use the what is called the define command. Can you see the define command here? I have a paper. I have actually two papers there. I can send you a paper. You can even build your own language, your own programming language. We have done that before, so I can send you a paper. All right, I think Adan is done. So let's continue with the classes. Okay, So coming back, okay, so now we're going to talk about the structure. No, it's not. It's a C library. It's a C library. This is the structure. We're going to show you the structure. Okay. Now, if you can use it, as I said before, you connect it to your laptop and you use whatever you want on your laptop. Okay. On your laptop, use whatever you want. Then through the serial port of your laptop, or through Wi-Fi, or through database, through the internet, you somehow communicate with that robot. And that's it. I'm more than happy to work with you on a number of projects if you want. I'm really open to collaboration. As long as they, you know, can produce a paper, I'm more than happy to work with you. Okay, so. So the structure, okay? Now the structure is a little bit different from normal, traditional, imperative programming. Okay, but it's, again, you just have to grasp. Once you get it, it's very easy. So this is the one similarity between games, robotics, and robotics, basically. So in traditional programming, okay, you basically describe sequentially what you want the system to do, right? And then the system will finish. That's it. Here you have an infinite loop. And you write your code inside a loop. So your code is running inside an infinite loop. This is the, so it takes few minutes for a programmer to change his thinking, you know? So what do we do here? Here we set in variables or anything we want, like in C++. Then you have a void setup. Here, this code is going to run one time only. So whatever code you place there, this code is going to run only once. So here what I am doing, I have a serial port, pre-declared serial port object. It's part of the library. And I'm just running the begin 9600. So this is going to establish a connection between the serial port and my computer, my laptop. If you need that, maybe you don't need to establish connection, maybe you just want to upload the code there and let it work separately. And then here, so basically whatever code you put in the setup is going to run only once at the beginning, once you start the system. And then you have the void loop. This is like your main. So what code you put here is going to run forever. So now I have a string W, and what am I doing? I am sending to the serial port www. So you will see on your laptop www all the time. So this is another application now, another program, okay, that is going to utilize the digital ports. So as I said, another difference apart from the structure is the specialized, the dedicated commands for digital I/O and analog I/O. Once again, the digital, just three commands. These three commands control these ports here, the top ones, while the analog ones control these ones. Very simple, right? Now, what are these three commands doing? Let's talk about the digital first. First of all, the pin mode command. Pin mode command has to declare to the operating system of the microcontrollers, of the microcontroller, if the specific port is going to be used for input or output. Input, receive electricity from a sensor, or output, send electricity to a device or a sensor. The next one, so I'm not with pin mode, I'm not sending anything. I'm just setting the mode, preparing the system to send or to listen. Now, the digital write is sending, the digital read is reading. So, three commands. We tell it to to prepare it, to send or to listen. So we prepare it, preparation, and then we send or read. That's it, three commands only. Very, very simple. Three commands. Okay, and here is an example of how we use these three commands. What I want to do, I want to make this LED here to blink, like on, off, on, off, on, off. So first of all, how we connect it? We have, we need two things, right? We need to take, we need electricity and ground, correct? Electricity and ground. So we take, we can take electricity from any digital port. In our case, port number 10. So we will take electricity from port number 10. You see this green here? These are connected basically. So we will give electricity from here. So the whole column here has electricity, okay? On the breadboard. This is how the breadboards look like. Like the columns have electricity. So if I connect, if I give electricity here, that means that electricity will go here to the resistance. Through the resistance, I just want to lower a little bit the electricity because I don't want to burn the LED. It will go to the LED, to the light, and to the ground. This is it. So it's a very small circuit. Just take electricity from here, give electricity from the one side, and from the other side to the ground. That's it. Like I plug it to the wall, two cables only. Very simple. All I have to do now, I have to go back to 10, because this is ground, right? Now, I have to go back to 10 and give electricity or stop. Give electricity or stop. So, step one, I have to declare to the operating system, what am I going to do with specific pin? Am I going to give electricity or am I going to receive electricity? So, what's the command for doing that? Pin mode here. Then the next one is the number of the pin. In our case is pin number 10. So pin mode, which pin I'm talking about? Pin number 10. And then this is a constant. It can be either input or output. So I will write output. Easy? Just one line. Pin number and input or output, in our case, output. This is in the setup because it's not going to change during the duration of my execution. Then, in the loop, in the voice loop, which is this code now runs forever, right? While this code runs only once, you do a digital write. Again, which pin I'm talking about? Pin 10. And I make it high. What is the meaning of high? Give electricity. Then I use a command called delay. Delay is going to stop it for 1,000 milliseconds, which means for 1 second. So give electricity. Then wait for 1 second. Then I do a digital write low. So I stop the electricity. And then again, I wait for 1 second. And this code will run forever because it's in the loop, right? So it's going to run forever. So you see how easy it is to actually build a device like this? On, off, on, off. So easy. We can see another example of coding with Arduino in the next slides. So we're just going to see an example of the commands. So yeah, the syntax is explained here. Okay, we all know this. Here is an example of an if statement in Arduino. So you have a variable, for example, 30. If it's more than 30, send to the serial port this number, else send this number. This is an example of a for loop. Again, everything that you know, right? everything as you know it. Do while arrays. Functions, some methods for trigonometry, like pole or square root, random numbers, time ones like millisecond, micros, delay microseconds. So you see, it's very serial port commands. So until now, everything was familiar, right? Now, here are the analog ports commands and the digital port commands. So for the digital port commands, pin mode, which is where you put the pin number and you put either input or output, and the digital read, just the pin number and you're listening from there. And the digital write, again, which pin you want and if you want high or low. Now, the analog port commands, I was planning to go back to the sensors and explain that, but it's okay. You have the, don't worry about this, ignore the first one. The main command, and ignore, this is a special command, I will not cover it now. So you only care about the analog read. So you just say, do an analog read from that pin. Okay, so what, here we have a number of example code, which I will not go right now, but what I will do, I will go back to this one, because now we know the Arduino commands, right? So I will go back to the code of this and show you how to actually connect the sensors to Arduino. Okay, so ultrasonic is a little bit difficult one. Let's go to an easier one. Okay, so let's say that I want now to connect these motors, or let's take an easier one. This is an easier one. Let's say I want to connect a servo motor, okay, to Arduino to control the motor, because we saw now how to control a light, okay? Let's try to control a motor instead. This is a servo motor. This is how it looks like, okay? And it has three cables. So what you do, you give power, ground, and any digital port you want. Am I clear? Power, ground from the Arduino board, top of the analog ports, and one digital port. So you include the servo library, and then you create an object of type servo. Let's call it servo one. In the setup, I call a command called attach. So servo one, which is my object, dot attach seven, which is the digital pin. And then in the loop, what I do, I have the command called write. These are write, attach, these are commands of the servo library, okay? But I just want to show you how easy it is. Sorry, I'm going very fast because of the time. I'm trying to shrink a 6 hour course into 2 hours, okay? So basically I have the object servo one dot write zero, delay dot write 1080. Now, as we said earlier, servos can move from 0 to 180 degrees. So if you can all see my hand now, 0 is here, 180 is here, 90 is in the middle. So they can do this movement. Okay? So if I program it, what is this code doing? It's going to servo 1, 0, which is here, wait for 2 seconds. Then 180, wait for 2 seconds, then again, 0, 180. So it's doing this movement. You see how easy it is, just what, 1, 2, 3, 4 lines only. And you have the control, so you can control the motor from the Arduino very easily. Now the DC motor is a little bit more complex because you're using a CL, okay? But again, it's not that hard. I mean, I will not explain this code now because it defeats the purpose of this seminar. This is just an introduction to show you basically how easy it is to build robots and how easy it is to interact between the computer and the hardware. Okay, but I have all the code in my lecture notes. Okay, here is how you connect it and how you program it. Now I will also show you how to connect the sensor, if I have some code, before we can move in. Okay, this is how we read from analog sensors. So let's assume that we have, let's say, a photocell, okay, for example, or a pressure sensor here. So how can I read this value? This is the code. In the loop, I have outside the loop a variable, okay? Then inside the loop, I just use the command analog read and the port. That's it. So this is four. This four here is the port that I'm reading from. So if I do an analog read four, I'm going to read the value from that port. And that's pretty much it. So it's very, very easy to read it. So if I, so shall we try to write a program now? Before I can move to how to connect this to the computer, Arduino to the computer through programming.
Oh yes, you can go ahead with the programming.
It's going to be a very, very simple one, okay? Let's create now, but we will do it together. I mean, this should be an interactive one, okay? I will only write what you tell me to write. So let's try to build the robot quickly, okay? But this is a class exercise, okay? So I deliver the things right now. I want you to tell me what to do. If you tell me wrong, I write wrong, okay? So let's create a simple system. Let's have a small application that if the light in a room is dark, I want to make a LED go on. Okay? So if the, yes, sorry. I want to collect sample, sorry. Yes, it will be applicable for any servo motor that, yes. So what we're trying to do right now, okay, right now we want to take input from the environment. So we will use a photocell. We will use the analog read command. Okay, I'm just going to type the command here. It's camel case, by the way. Analog read command, and it takes a port number here. Okay, and we're going to use the digital, so the pin mode commands, and we're going to use the digital write commands. So what is the scenario? The scenario here is we check how much light we have in the room. If the room is dark, we want the light to be on. If the room is bright, because it's day or something, we want the light to be off. That's all. So who can tell me the code? I can go back to the lecture notes or in any example you want, but I think we don't need it. So first of all, how we connect it? Let's load our Arduino again. So first of all, how we will connect it, okay? By the way, I even have an exam if you guys want to try it home, but let's do it here for now. So save the time. Okay, so we said the photocell is an analog sensor, right? So I'm going to connect it to the one of the analog ports. Let's say analog port one, number one. Okay, now the light, I will connect it to 10, like before. Okay, so now that we are done with the connections, let's go back to the code. So we have a photocell connected to one, analog one. Okay, and we have the LED connected to digital then. Okay, so, and by default, I have a void set up. And a void loop. So, help me. What can I write here? Sorry, but person cannot go to community. I would like to send robot. No need to define any variables. We can do it directly. Yeah, pin mode 10 output, correct. So in the setup, directly pin mode 10 output. So what we did now, we say that we are setting the digital, no need for serial begin. We are not going to use the serial. Directly, we said that serial is if you want to connect to the computer. We will see that after this example. So what we did, we say to the system, listen, for digital port pin, we're going to send electricity. Then I'm in the loop, okay? In the loop, what I'm going to say, I need an if statement, right? Somehow. So if, okay, what am I going to put here? The command is here, you can see all the commands. Okay. Okay, what am I going to put here? What number? N. Are you sure? Yes. So this now, this thing here is a number from 0 to 1023. So if this one, let's say, is more than 800, which means the room is bright, then what we do? Off. Digital right. Then low. Else, if the room is dark, or actually, you know, just for the thing, it would be better to have it like this, so we can fit in the screen. Else, what I'm going to do, sorry, else high. Done. That's all. We just completed our first code. So this is the code here. So what we do, we set the pin mode 10 to output. And then in the loop, we say, if the input from the digital port is more than 800, then there is light in the room, so switch the light off. Else, switch the light on. So I'm just going to send you a solution here. That's for a reference keeping. Okay. So very simple, very easy, right? Nothing scary. Now, we will continue because we'll go to the last part of today's class. By the way, I skipped a lot of information because I tried to shrink it. Okay, I will share. I will do something better than sharing references. I'm going to give you my lecture notes, so you can use this as a template to design your own course. And I can support you if you want to design your own courses. Now, this is the last part of today's class. Okay. Okay. So what do we have now? We have, we know the logic. That is an IPO system, right? So we have some sensors connected to Arduino or another microcontroller, and we have the motors connected to Arduino. And this Arduino can do some simple processing. So this is the basic structure. We are all familiar with that. We even know how to program. Very simple stuff, right? Now, let's go to the advanced, shall we? If we want to do something advanced, Arduino is not good enough. I want to use C#, I want to use Java, I want to use OpenCV for image recognition, I want to use machine learning with Python, I want to use all this advanced stuff, right? So this small board is not good enough. If I, even if I use Raspberry Pi, it's a little bit more advanced, still not good. I need a computer, I need the power of a laptop or a power of a computer to do that. Plus, we are all computer science, right? So we are all more familiar with computers than these small circuits. So what we need to do, we can keep that small circuit with simple code for hardware interaction to interact with sensors and motors, and we can have our computer for the main processing, for the hardware, which means we have to have a connection, runtime connection, between that board and the computer through the serial board. And this is how we're going to do that. So I'm going to show you C# and Java examples, but you can find examples in Python or much any language. Simply users of the serial board, that's it. So first of all, we have to set it up at the Arduino side. So step one, set it up in the Arduino side. And this is how, oh, sorry, I think I. Sorry, I'm just trying to find the Arduino side. Here is the Arduino site, okay? Sorry, I mean, I included a lot of things here because I wanted to make it complex, but it's, don't be scared, okay? It's very simple, it's one line code. I just wanted to show all the possibilities here. So what you do here, basically you have the, I mean, please ignore these things, okay? I can even delete them, guys. If it's looks scary, I can delete them, okay? Please try to concentrate here. We don't bother with all these things. It's void setup, ignore the ones above, okay? Void setup, I do a serial.begin at a speed. It can be 9200, it can be any speed you want. But the same speed, the same number of baud rates, you have to put in the other side. So whatever number you put here, the same number has to be in the C# or in Java. And then you have void loop. In the void loop, what I'm doing? I'm doing a serial, so I have a serial. I'm starting the serial connection. So now there is a communication, two ways communication between the Arduino and the laptop at a speed. Now, serial.available tell us if there are available data, because I have a buffer, right? So I know if there are data in the buffer to listen. So if it's more than zero, that means that I have a number of data available here, ready to be grabbed. Then, again, please ignore this rubbish code. Okay, this is just to make it look. I'm just taking all the possibilities here, so all the commands. Please, please, please ignore it, okay? So I can do a serial.read. And that's the command. So basically, I just check if the data is available or not. If there is data to be read, just use the command serial.read. That's all. So Arduino can read from there. And if you want, so this is how Arduino can receive data from your computer, through the serial.read. That's all, okay? One command only. Two better.
is available, read. That's it. Two commands. Is available, read. Now, how can Arduino send to the computer? Arduino can send to the computer through the print here. Serial.print. And then you can print an integer, a string, whatever you want to send. So, how many commands for communication in total? Three commands. Available, to check when we are reading, if we have data in the buffer waiting for us to be read. Read, serial.read, grab the data, serial.print, to send data from the Arduino to the laptop, to the computer. So are we okay with the Arduino part? Just three commands, right? Check if there are data waiting for me, I can read them, and then I can write. And of course, the serial.begin to start the serial. So four commands. Are we clear from the Arduino side of communication? Are we all clear with that? I want to see some yes in the chat, please. Four different commands. Okay. Four means four different commands. Available. Serial dot. So serial dot begin. Serial dot available. Serial dot read. Serial dot print. Now that we're okay with the serial port side of the Arduino, let's move to some C# code. So this is, I mean, you have to use, you can find better examples in the internet, but the command in C# for setting up the serial port is like you set up a serial port, my serial port. So you create an instance, an object of serial port. You can name it COM3 or COM4 or whatever. You have to check whatever the connection is. So you have to check the connection from your device manager. Maybe it's COM3, COM4, whatever. That has to match. Okay? So this has to match whatever is in your there. And this is the speed. Again, and the speed has also to match. I have a handshaking algorithm that I have developed to automate this process. But leave that for now. I mean, that's kind of more advanced. So here it's, we set up a new serial port. And in a size an exception handling, I do an open and a close. Okay, so this is how to set up the serial port. Now, how we can read it from serial port? Again, there are many ways to do that. Okay, so basically, if I want, sorry, actually this is writing to the serial port, not reading. So what I do, I have my serial port and I use the command .call.write. So basically, if you want to read or write, you're just using the commands again. Read, byte, char, line, or whatever you want to read. So these are all the possible reads. And these are the possible writes. So again, from the C# side, it's very easy, right? Read or write. Very, very simple stuff. But don't forget, it's not a one-off thing, okay? It's a continuous thing. So there are three strategies, or you can put it in an infinite loop, which is highly not recommended. So I can have an infinite loop on a separate thread, reading the data. About rates can be anything, anything as long as it matches. It can be anything. As long as it's match Arduino, it can be anything. I can put here 100, but the other side should be 100 as well. Okay, so anything as long as they both match. They are separate examples, by the way, that's why. They don't have to fit. Okay, so you can put anything. The typical one is 9600. But I'm using higher speeds anyway. I'm using different numbers. As long as they're both the same. So COM port, the name of the COM port and the speed must match. So these are all the possible reads. So you can read the byte, read the char, read line, and check if there is something to read. And these are the possible writes. You can write a line. It's the command, basically, write a line. That's it. Actually, no, it's supposed to be print. Sorry, something is wrong here. Ah, no, sorry. This is for the console. Sorry, I'm confused. Sorry. So this is just the reading, right? This is for writing to the console what we read. Sorry, because it's a similar command. It's also serial.write. That's why I was confused. So I'm just going to cover the writing since we covered it. So here it is. Yeah, this is how you write. So in the object of serial port, you just call the command write. And you can write whatever you want. So it's serial.write or write line. So this is how you send from the computer to the serial. Now, as I said before, there are many, when we are writing, it's clear. When we are reading, we can either have an infinite loop in a separate thread to keep listening, or even better, we use events. You're all familiar with events, event handling. So you set an event for the serial port. So when data arrive to the serial port, we simply read the data and append. We call a method. Okay, so we will see. I have examples of everything here and the inputs include if you want. That's for Java. Java works in exactly the same way. I'm not going to cover it as well. Same code, you open a serial port, you create an event, you're listening, you're writing. Same way. So yeah, I'm not going to continue about that. I want to keep the rest of the time for questions and answers. So this concludes the delivery of the material today. I'm now open for questions. I can see more examples if you want. I will leave stage now to the audience. So no questions, everything is clear. So Isman, yeah.
Hello, sir. Hello.
Yes, hello. Yes.
So I have one question. Let's say that I have written one program for Arduino to connect, let's say, LDR. And second one, I have written one program in Java, again to communicate with serial port with other sensors. So can I interface with the Arduino with Java? How it is compatible? This Java code, how can I embed in Arduino or like that?
Sorry, did you watch the last part of the class? 1 second.
Yeah, sir.
Uh-huh. Okay, so coming back to what I just said, so you have to include this input, just the serial port, okay? It's just a serial port communication.
Okay.
So through the USB, you connect it to the lab. You will create, you have to create a port. This is automatically looking for ports, basically. This is listening.
Uh-huh.
You just don't find the code where you actually create. This is Java code, by the way. You have to create an object of type port. You have to give the COM port, okay, and the serial. And then you create an event, which is listening to the serial port.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And then based on that event, you have your sensors and you have basically connection. I saw a detailed example before. Actually, this is, this is for changing different colors. This is the event listener. I didn't focus too much here because I saw an example on C#, right? So C# is identical to Java. So here, for example, this is in C# code, which is identical to Java. You're creating an object of serial port, which is a home port and boundaries. And then you just use the, for this object now has a write line, and read commands, which you can use to interface with Arduino.
Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Well, okay. Again, IoT is done using, no, IoT is not done using any of them. Okay. These are just some vendor-specific applications. Some of them are using Arduino inside. Most of them probably are using what I just told you inside. Now, what you're talking about here, it's a higher layer of communication. Okay. So you're talking about how to talk to these devices, or you know, we have Alexa, Amazon Alexa here. We have, I have Alexa here. I have my Facebook portal. I have Alexa. I have Google Assistant that are controlling these smart houses devices. Okay. Now this has nothing to do with today's class. Today's class is at the how we actually implement this at the lower level, how we develop these devices, not about how we communicate these devices, or how we use higher level frameworks such as Google Assistant, Alexa, and so on to control them, like on to integrate them. So this is not about integration to a framework. This is today's class was about building, construction, manufacturing a product, manufacturing not a service. Product. Did I answer your question? Alexa, did I answer the question? Useless. You said, no, I don't know anything. All right. So yeah, I mean, this is how to actually build the sensors that you can later on integrate with Google Assistant and so on. We can have another class for how to connect your custom devices to Google Assistant, or how to write programs for Alexa and Google Assistant. That's another thing. Serial is not for control, no. Serial is just to connect the laptop with the computer with the Arduino. So that will allow you to have another platform, basically. You have a computer for advanced processing. So you have MATLAB, for example, and connect MATLAB to the serial port with, or Simulink, and connect to the serial port with Arduino for the purpose of communication. Now, I keep talking about connecting laptop. However, for the purpose of robotics, nowadays, we have some integrated, we call them single board computers. So I'm just going to share, if you just allow me. I hope you can see my screen, right? For example, let's go for Latte Panda. Okay, this is Latte Panda. So this is, again, a single board computer, this one here. It has everything that a computer has, absolutely everything, okay? USBs, Windows 10 inside. It has an Intel CPU. So we can see the specs here. Hope you can see the specs here. Way communication, yeah, okay. They can even connect a 1050i GPU for test. So, you know. So basically, this is a full computer. Okay, I hear the specs. So, it has 4 thread cores, it has 8 GB of RAM, memory, it has extensions, right? It has the mobile, 8th generation mobile CPU, Intel, okay, as a main processor. And at the same time, it has Arduino inside, which means we get all the analog here. We can get, sorry, I'm just trying to find an image here. So here we can get all the analog ports and the digital ports of Arduino, in addition to a normal computer with Windows 10 that we know. which means we can use exactly the code, the serial connection, to establish a permanent connection between the Intel CPU here inside this board and the Arduino also inside this board. And this is what is used in modern robots. All modern robots are using this, which is a normal computer. You plug a USB, a HDMI monitor, and keyboard and mouse, and with Windows 10, and you use it as a normal computer. And if you want something more powerful, you can go for the UDU, which is the most powerful one. It's actually a super powerful one. Okay, this is UDU. Okay, so this is one even more powerful, the UDU 86. It has an embedded Ryzen inside. So with Vega graphics. So this is even more powerful. You can add here memory, DDR4 memory. You can add the M2 hard drive, SSD. You can add pretty much everything here. So this is another single board computer, even more powerful than the previous one. Okay, now it is available in India. Both of them are available in India. Not from Amazon IN, but Amazon India is not the only site. You can go for the DF robot for Latte Panda, and you can order this UDU, which is the most powerful one, here directly from the website. Also, you can buy them from eBay. But you can buy directly from the website. Okay, so this is what we're actually using. So this is a single board computer with normal Windows 10. It's like your laptop, and this is more powerful than some of your laptops. This is more powerful than some laptops. These are the specs. It's a very powerful system. This one. So basically, it's a full mini computer. This is what usually we have inside. And this has both Arduino and normal Intel CPU, or AMD CPU in that case, inside. Which means, again, you do a serial connection. So you have Windows. And through the serial connections, you connect to the Arduino part and start connecting using the ports and so on. So actually, this is the board. This is just computer. I saw you. I gave you the wrong one. It's a UDU 86 that we need. Not the board. The board is you want just computer, okay? Sorry, I gave you the wrong one. It's UDU 86. This one, because it has the Arduino ports here. Okay, sorry. Ignore my previous link, please. This is the UDU. It's the same company, but this is the one you need. Because it has all the serial ports here like Arduino. So this has both Arduino and Intel CPU. And as you can see, it has Intel graphics and so on. Or of course, you can take the board, as I showed you before, or any computer, even an old motherboard with a normal desktop computer or something, use an Arduino, connect them together. I mean, you will probably want to do that if you go for a bigger robot. So if you have the space and the energy, it's like a robot plug on the electricity or something, you can use a desktop. You can use an old desktop, connect it with Arduino, and then, put it in a book, and that's it. Connect all the sensors and motors. So any more questions?
I think there are no pending questions. Can you please share your contact details, Professor George, in the chat window?
I think I'm going to share the lecture notes. Do you want me to drag and drop them now, or I can email them to you? I can email you the a zip file with all the lecture notes. Everything is there. If you need any information, you can come back.
Yeah, I will share the details with the other participants. So if they would like to continue with their work and need your help, they will contact you at your email.
Absolutely.
Yeah, thank you so much for a very insightful topic, and you have covered lots of things during this 2-hour session.
Yes, I'm really happy to collaborate. I'm looking forward to collaboration.
Yeah, I'm just checking the availability of Uda sir.
Yeah, Dr. George. Wonderful talk. And these talks are the first initial step to enter into collaboration.
Absolutely.
Only after handshaking, few out of them will go for collaboration. So thank you so much. And I can remember that every day you used to keep in mind that there is a talk at BVICAM. Okay, thank you so much. It was wonderful. I personally attended your entire talk.
Thank you so much, Professor. Thank you so
much. As memory from this program, a certificate is here for you. So congratulations.
Thank you. And thank you for your audience. I think a few people were interested.
Yes.
Obviously, these very technical topics are not.
Somewhere
audience than more managerial ones. But
somewhere or other, we need to expose the faculty members about the technology. We are just exposing them. Rest all depends upon their interest.
Yes, exactly. So.
Correct.
And we want to show that it's not rocket science. I mean,
true.
It's quite simple, really, sometimes.
Yes.
To develop such application. And my focus was to show how simple and how easy it is to develop. Applications.
Many people are giving you the appreciation messages in the chat window, Professor George.
Yeah. I saw. Thank you. Yes. I just hope I help you to clarify things and, as you said, expose you, introduce you to these technologies, these emerging technologies. That was the aim of the seminar. I don't expect anybody to learn how to build professional robots, but at least it was a starting point. May initiate something.
Yes, it was a wonderful session. Thank you very much for giving your valuable time to us. And it was a great privilege to have you during this 2 weeks faculty development program. And we will hope we will meet soon at BVICAM. And we missed you at IndiaCom 2020.
We will try to, I cannot commit because of the virus, but we will see. I'm already.
No, you have to come. No need to try, but you have to come in at 2021.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you very much to all the participants. We will meet on tomorrow at 10:45 and we'll start the session at 11 o'clock. Thank you.